lecture series for the Big Bear Valley Astronomical Society. This evening, we have a real treat for you. We're going to try something a little different tonight. You may notice that instead of having the talking head on the small screen over there, we have the talking head on the big screen up here. We've switched places between the presentation and the talk, and that's because this evening, Tom McMahon, who is engineering manager for the Large Binocular Telescope Observatory in Arizona, is going to give us a live walkthrough of the telescope. And if we are fortunate enough, we may be able to get to actually watch the dome open and the telescope slew for the beginning of the evening. Tom said that they're scheduled to go dome open at 6:45, so that should happen before the end of the talk tonight. We've never done this before, so don't be surprised if we lose connection a couple of times as he's walking through that big giant metal labyrinth called the Large Binocular Telescope Observatory. Tom McMahon, both Therese and I have known for probably more years than any of us want to admit. We met Tom as undergraduates way back when, before Therese and I were married and before Tom was married. Oh, we've lost your video again. Tom has had a quite varied career. After leaving Sonoma State University, he spent several years working for the Kuiper Airborne Observatory, the predecessor to SOFIA that we've heard about here. After that, he went to Salt Lake, University of Utah for his master's. I'm doing this from memory, so Tom, correct me if I'm forgetting
something. You're doing fine.
After that, he spent many years working at Yerkes Observatory. We all sort of assumed that our careers had diverged radically until, somewhat of a surprise to us, he suddenly accepted a project manager position with the University of Arizona. So suddenly we were in the same city again. As it turned out, Teresa ended up working for Tom for 7 years, building one of the instruments for the Large Binocular Telescope, the interferometer. I was kind of hoping that Teresa would be able to give this introduction this evening, since they worked quite closely together for quite a few years. Unfortunately, Teresa had oral surgery a couple of days ago and isn't speaking much this evening. And she's only showing one side of her face at the moment. So this evening, again, please join me in welcoming Tom McMahon.
Hello, everyone. I'm glad that I was invited and happy to give a walkthrough of the facility that I work in. Now, I don't have pictures of my slides right now, but I want to do a test here. So if I go to my slides, I want to know if my camera turns off.
Yes.
Okay. So at least for a brief moment, so I can get my bearings on which slides I'm talking about, perhaps just the slides will do, since I won't be moving around and just a floating head isn't that exciting. So I want to talk about what the LBT is. So the LBT is the Large Binocular Telescope.
Not easily.
It's one of the world's largest telescopes. This is slide number one. It's located on Mount Graham in Graham County, Southeast Arizona, at an altitude of 10,500 and some odd feet. So there's a picture of Mount Graham. It's got a nice cumulus cloud over it that was taken by me on the road up during the summer. So it gets a lot of moisture in the monsoons. So the telescope was built and is operated by a consortium of universities and educational centers across the world. Arizona, University of Arizona is one of them. Italy, Germany, and I say RC Partners, which is an additional collaboration of many universities with small percentages of the time on the telescope. And so they all contribute to the construction of the facility and the maintenance of the facility, and they all get a portion of the number of nights during the year. So we've been operating the telescope. So the telescope has been going up in the sky since 2007, and we've had basically fully commissioned telescope since about 2013. So, what is the telescope? The telescope is quite large. It has two 8.4-meter mirrors as the primaries that are separated by 6 meters. So, side to side, the telescope is 23 meters across. So that's, you know, if you think of a single telescope on a single mount, it's definitely the world's largest telescope right now. It has two spectacular... Yes.
Could you quickly convert that into feet for some of the people here?
Into feet. Oh my gosh.
What are friends for?
Can I do that at 10,000 feet? You're asking. It is let's just say a meter is 30 is 4 feet. Yeah. And so 8 times 4 is what? Tell me.
Pardon me.
Oh, here, I can bring up a camera. I'll do that on my screen.
Okay. Talk. I used to. So we do everything since the telescope was built in Italy, so everything is metric on it. So we don't deal with English units anymore. So we also have two really, really fantastic...
27 feet across.
27?
27.3 is the primary. And then the separation is big.
Yeah, separation big. So each one is 27, so that's 50 with 6 in the middle. So we're talking about, 65.
Sounds about right.
Feet. Okay. 65 feet across.
Thank you. Okay. Sorry to put you on the spot.
All right. That's all right. And so we have two secondaries, so which are at on swing arms above the telescope, above the primaries. And they're roughly 4 feet in diameter. And then we have 12 instrument stations or focal stations spread out throughout the telescope. Some are at the prime focus, which are prime focus cameras, very wide field cameras. Two are at the direct Gregorian, which is through the primary mirror. And we have 8 stations in between the primary mirrors. Cells or primary mirrors, which are called the bent Gregorian stations. So this is basically the slide 3 is where just exactly what I just said, but which ones are they? So we have a suite of instruments that are operating on an almost daily night. So we open every night except for the monsoons. We have the wide field front focus cameras, which are visible. They take beautiful images of a very large, I think a 24 by 36 arc minute field of view, which for a large telescope is quite large.
Almost the full moon.
Yeah.
Almost the full moon, yes. We have the Lucy instruments, which are near infrared spectrometers, which operate from roughly 1 micron to 1.6 microns. So I should go back and say this telescope is a thermal infrared telescope. So it is optimized for the infrared observations. And so a large fraction of our instruments are actually infrared, in the infrared. So the Lucys are in the infrared, the MODs, which are visible spectrometers, are mounted underneath the primaries at the direct Gregorian. Another very super high resolution spectrometer down in the pier, which You know, in a classical sense, it would be the Coudé focus, but it's actually a fiber-fed instrument. So it resides in a thermally controlled room below the telescope. So, but the instrument that I find the most interesting and I have the most pride in is the LBTI, which sits at the middle of the telescope, which is the infrared interferometer that Teresa and I helped build. And it is, I'll talk a little bit about the science that that it delivers. So one might ask, why do you want to build a telescope with two primary mirrors? So there's a significant reason. There's a real good reason. One is that these mirrors were spun cast at the University of Arizona Mirror Lab by a guy named Roger Angel, who pioneered the spin casting technique, which basically takes years off of the polishing and grinding of large optics. And they are actually compared to, say, the Palomar, which is nearly a solid slab of glass, incredibly lightweight for their size. So the technology limit for the spin cast is 8.4 meters. So to build a bigger telescope larger than 8.4 meters, you need to use multiple 8.4 meter segments. So this is really the one of the first of a new generation of ultra-large telescopes using multi-segments, similar to the Keck telescope. And similar to the picture that I show here, the MMT, the original MMT, which had six 1.4 meter segments that was pioneered by the same team who built this telescope back in the 70s.
I might point out that the MMT is on a mountain south of Tucson. Where Tom is, the LBT, that's on Mount Graham, which is about 100 miles east of Tucson. So University of Arizona has observatories on several mountaintops around Arizona and is partnered in South America as well. Sorry.
So in comparison, the LBT collecting area has a little bigger collecting area than a single Keck. So the single Keck has a 10-meter collecting area, and the LBT has the equivalent of 12 meters. So there's some contention that, you know, if we call ourselves the world's largest telescope, other astronomers and other observatories say, oh, no, that's not true because you just have two telescopes on one mount. So the key there is that you can combine the beams together to form a telescope that is 8.5 meters deep and 23 meters wide. But not every instrument on our suite of instruments do that, but the LBTI, the interferometer in the center of the telescope, is able to combine those that light at the infrared wavelengths, giving us a much better resolution than a single 10-meter telescope, and giving us the best resolution of any telescope in existence right now.
Really?
And we use that instrument for to study extrasolar planets and to resolve them. And the next slide, so this is slide six now. So one of the key elements that allow us to do super high resolution imaging, not only just the telescope, but we have these adaptive optics secondaries. And an adaptive optics secondary, adaptive optics basically take the twinkling or the scintillation of the starlight out of the star. So basically it's subtracting the effects of the atmosphere makes on the light coming from the star. So you can think of being at the bottom of a pool and looking up at somebody's face, it's all distorted. That's what our atmosphere is doing to the starlight. So it's a bumpy and wavy wave that hits the telescope. So the adaptive optics system actually measures the deformity of that wave and shapes a mirror in the opposite direction so that the wave is now a nice, smooth, spherical surface. And so we, at the wavelengths that the interferometer is working at, can we can achieve the theoretical diffraction limit of the telescope, which is milli arc seconds of resolution. So it is it's incredibly fine. It's better than any telescope, any other telescope on Earth right now. And we pioneered this, and every other telescope wants one. So the team that is building these adaptive secondaries are very busy constructing them for other telescopes. So what makes this telescope an infrared optimized telescope is that we have reduced the number of mirrored surfaces between the star and the detector to just four warm surfaces. And in a classical AO system, you have up to 40 surfaces, warm surfaces. And each warm surface contributes to the brightness background of the patch of sky that you're looking at. So it reduces the contrast of your measurement so that you have to dwell longer. So with a telescope like this and an infrared instrument, we can reduce the contrast so that we can see incredibly faint objects around distant stars, such as planets. So with the instruments that we are using here tonight and in a short period, throughout the year, we are looking at many objects. Tonight they're looking at quasi-stellar objects, quasars. But early next week, the LBTI team will be looking at young planetary disks around distant stars with their instrument. So they're particularly looking at, so next slide, I haven't been telling you, I'm on slide 8 now. So we're looking at big Jupiters, young Jupiters that are emitting light in the near infrared, and our camera that we have developed over the years that Teresa participated in is tailored to observe the emission from those young Jupiter-sized planets. Okay, so that's a technique called knowing interferometry. The other ways that we can observe with our instruments is called physoimaging. These are all part of combining the beams together and getting ultra high resolution images. So this is the one of the few telescopes that can do what's called physoimaging, which is combining the beam together but able to sample a wide field of view simultaneously. So the Keck telescopes, the twin 10 meter in Hawaii, do interferometry as well. However, they use something called Michelson interferometry, which you can think of as taking a single sample of a field and then moving your detector and taking another sample. So it takes them quite a while to build up an image over their field. While this telescope, because we're on a single mount and the light is reaching our detector on both sides of the telescope simultaneously, allows us to do a much more efficient job of doing that. Okay, so that was the last one, a little brief about the physo imaging. So that was slide 10 and slide 11. So now I want to just throw it open to some questions, and I would like to take you on a walking tour of the telescope enclosure. And there's a couple pictures that I've included here. So the first one, which is slide 11, which is a picture of one of the primaries. So you can see that as Claude says, it's, I think it was 23 feet across. 27 feet across.
No.
This is a picture that I took up near the front of the telescope. So the telescope in this orientation is looking to the horizon, so it's pointing on its side. But you can see on the left-hand side of the picture are the instrument gallery. So that is where, just behind that red wall and those round openings, are the sensitive infrared and visible instruments that I was referring to. And so the light would come from, hit the primary, go back up to the secondary, and there's an arm, there's a structure that's sitting in directly in front of the mirror, which is the tertiary swing arm. So it is a cantilever that holds a flat mirror that directs the beam of the telescope into any one of those instruments in the instrument gallery. So it is steerable, so we can at any time move from one instrument to the next. And it's typical during a night to have multiple instruments used. So the next picture, next set of pictures, there's actually two pictures cut in half. The leftmost is I'm standing up on the front of the telescope looking to the horizon along the line of sight of the telescope. And what I'm seeing here in the lower part with the blue stripes is the prime focus camera. So this is a big cryogenically cooled camera with four CCDs mosaic together that it's out of the beam right now, so it's not in use at this point, but it would swing into the beam and intercept all the optics. And so the light from the object that you're imaging hits the primary and goes directly into the camera. So no other optics are used. And then directly on the pedestal above is a portion of the secondary. So I have just been, the lights have just been turned off on me.
Oh,
so
no.
I have to make my way. And of course, I forgot my, I left my flashlight in the control room.
Oh,
that's cool.
So I'm going to make my way slowly. So this means that they're probably going to open the vent doors pretty soon. So I just have to make sure I don't run into anything. The adaptive secondary is actually in the beam here. And in the right side picture, I'm standing directly in front of the primary mirror, taking a picture of myself in the primary mirror. And directly behind me is the adaptive secondary. Already placed in the beam. Okay, I made it out of the chamber. Okay, the next couple of pictures, I think the last pictures I have here, are just to give you a scale of the telescope. So the people that you see here are standing in front of the interferometer, in between the two primaries. So you can get a sense of the scale of the telescope itself. And then the one on the right is looking down on its big platform at one of the Lucy infrared spectrometer images. It's kind of hard to kind of get a scope of this, but you can think of the telescope as a building inside of a building, because the total structure that I'm standing in is about 12 stories tall. The enclosure where the telescope sits is approximately 5 to 9, so it's about 6 stories tall. So the telescope just barely fits inside the building. So the telescope is about 5 stories tall. And so what I'm going to do, since I hadn't talked to the telescope operator, I want to see if I can get the lights back on so that we can have a little peek at the instrument gallery off the telescope. Hang on a second. David, are you on?
Now keep in mind, this is an experiment on being live, so we have to...
David, is it possible to have the light back in the chamber for a brief moment?
There's no building in Big Bear that's that tall.
Okay, so I'm going to go back to Skype.
Good boy.
And... So, you're not going to see me. Here I am.
Oh,
I'm going to turn the camera around. They just turned the lights back on, but it'll be a minute or two before it comes back on.
Okay, we are getting video now.
Okay. I'm going to just go back down the stairs briefly, because that's where the lights start to come on a little strongly at first. Okay. So, I'm standing at the back of the chamber, and what you can probably see at this point is there's a red shape over here. My fingers.
We see it. Okay. Yeah.
So that is the instrument, one of the spectrometers that is sitting behind the primary. And the primary is still a little dark, but the lights take a few minutes to come back on. And so I'm standing basically behind and under the primary. And now I'm going to move to the front of the telescope. The telescope right now is pointing to the zenith, or pointing straight up. David, is it possible to get the floods on? Is it possible to get the floods, the upper floods? There we go. Okay, so it's hard to get the scale. I'm going to stand back as far from the telescope as possible. David, do you, can you tell me when you're going to open the vent doors?
I'm
Oh, excellent. Thanks. Okay, we'll have more light in a few minutes because they're going to open up the vent doors. So it's still bright sunlight outside. The enclosure stays closed while the sun is up. So as soon as, you can see here, the vent doors are just opening right now.
Yay.
And so I'm looking at the, I'm standing in front of the telescope, looking at what's called the SX, or the left side. So it's called SX because this is an Italian-built telescope. Left in Italy is Italian and sinistra. So it's the left side, SX side. And so as you can see, the telescope or the vent door is opening. It's getting much brighter in here. You're looking at the primary mirror, which is the kind of the red tub. I'll point here. This is the primary mirror right there.
Now,
and what's that?
Tom, now the entire structure you're standing on rotates with the telescope, as I recall. And so you can't say north, south, east, or west, really, because the entire building rotates. Is that correct?
That's correct. So the telescope actually moves slightly independently of the building by 3 degrees on each side.
Oh.
But the telescope and the building are mostly slaved together. So here, I don't know if you can tell, but the telescope is moving to horizon now. So I don't have a super wide field. Actually, maybe I could turn it, if I turn it sideways.
Oh, that's great. That's great. That's great.
Yeah, so it didn't actually get it all the way to horizon, but he was moving it. Anyway, so as the light increases, you can see there's a silver bars in between a red kind of flat planes on either side. And then on the left and the right, you see these black spidery objects. So the telescope is made of C-rings, which are these two silver items. I'll try to point again. So here and here. Those are the C-rings. So that's actually the hydrostatic drive of the telescope. And then the silver beams that are in the center of the telescope are called wind bracing. And they hold the telescope, you know, firmly together, the two sides of the telescope firmly together. And then the black items that you see mostly on the right here, so this is the secondary arms. So right now, there's the prime focus camera is here, it's out of the beam, and the secondary is there, which is in the beam. And there is another structure here, which is the tertiary, so it's the third mirror of the telescope, which at this point is out of the beam. And before observing spectrometers, or the ones that are at the bottom of the telescope tonight, so they won't put that tertiary in. So do you have a question?
No, your audio and video broke up for just a moment, but you're okay now.
Yeah, I'm now standing in more or less an open building, so it's getting a little windy. So there may be some additional noise. So what they were doing, they moved the telescope slightly to check the balance. And so it's most likely will stay at the zenith position as until the sun sets. So the sun actually hasn't set, but they've rotated the whole building so that the sun is no longer isn't coming through the openings. So now you can see the big aperture on the side of the building. This is actually on the side, so that's not the aperture that the telescope looks through, but it's the ventilation door. And there are four of these. There's two at the back of the telescope and two on the sides, and here's the other one. And I'm not sure, you can see the mountains in the background once the auto...
Oh, that's gorgeous. That is gorgeous.
Beautiful.
Right, so I'm getting blasted by wind here, but I'm looking...
It's okay, we're fine here.
Yeah. I know.
So the mountains in the background are, which ones are those? Which direction am I looking? I'm looking, oh, okay. So if I were to look that way, I'm looking directly towards Tucson. So the mountain that I'm looking at is Mount Lemmon. So Teresa and Claude know about that. You guys don't know anything about Mount Lemmon, but there's another telescope up there. And it's the mountain right outside of Tucson. So I'm gonna walk around now that there's a little more light, so you can see the primary.
Jesus Christ.
So here's this big, huge structure. This instrument actually rotates to counter-rotate the telescope itself. So since this is an alt azimuth or a horizon and elevation mount, the sky rotates as you track a star during the course of a night. So to keep the instrument field from rotating, they have counter rotators, and so the whole instrument rotates very slowly in a counter rotation mode that is opposite and the same magnitude as the field is rotating.
Now, keep in mind, each one of these mirrors is, for those of you who've seen our Big Bear solar telescope here, Each one of these mirrors is about five times the size of our mirror here, to give
so
us some idea.
I'm gonna make a jaunt up the stairs.
A leap.
So I'm going from level 5 to level 6, and forgive the huffing and puffing because the altitude is just enough to get me, and I'm out of shape. I'm not in as good a shape as I should be. So here I've arrived at the primary mirror. So I'm looking at the edge of the primary mirror here. So I'll turn this way. So if you recall in the other picture that I showed on the slide, there was the instrument gallery. I'm looking at the instrument gallery right there. And the 27-foot mirror is right here. And then the secondaries are out there. So it's a very short, squat telescope. And it fits into a relatively small building. And the way that was achieved, so I should go back and make a qualification. The smaller the building you have, the cheaper it is to build. So the telescope was designed to not only be an effective observing tool, but it was designed as squat as possible to fit into as small of a building to reduce cost. So that was made possible by being able to spin cast these primary mirrors, which are F1.1, which are incredibly fast. So for those of you who make telescopes or use telescopes, a typical Celestron telescope or Meade, I think they're F23 or something like that. So they're rather slow. This one is just a big, huge bucket to catch the photons.
We think of our primary here as being very fast at F2.4. So this is This is twice as fast as the NSO, I mean the BBSO NST.
Of course, right. You're not trying to melt things with it, are you?
So what you see here, there's a kind of machine, and Claude and Teresa could tell you that we don't have mirror covers, and it's quite dusty around here. And so there's quite a bit of dust on the primaries right now. One of the goals that I've had in the last year is to actually get mirror covers on this telescope, and by next year we should have mirror covers on the telescope. So I'm working out right now. So I've moved from the, I don't want to make anybody sick as I move, so I'm going to pan over here. So this is the back end of the telescope, and there's a platform that you can walk. So I can't walk on the telescope right now because it is active and it can move at any time. And so if I walked out there, I may go for a ride, and I don't want to go for a ride to Horizon. But you can see that the structure has platforms that you can walk on. It is basically bigger than my two-story house, easily. And then there's even a new deck up there that Claude and Teresa probably haven't seen since it hasn't been that long since it's been up there. It's kind of like a patio that you can sit in on. So I wanted to explain the enclosure just a little bit, and I'll turn my camera again to get the vertical motion. So I'm looking again at the primary, and I'm looking to the front of the enclosure. So the wall that I see in the background, the metal wall that I see in the background, is actually the shutter of the dome. And when the dome opens, there will be an unobstructed view from the horizon all the way to the back, to those the crane that you see above me right now. So all that structure above the telescope on both sides is free. So the telescope can observe nearly to the horizon all the way to the zenith. So, and perhaps if you guys are interested, I'd be willing to wait around for the telescope to open, and it is quite spectacular when the rest of the dome opens. So...
I see a lot of head shaking here.
Okay.
Up and down.
So I'm standing at the very back of the telescope, center back of the telescope. And the picture that you saw of the people standing in front of the interferometer, I'm basically where the camera person was. Mm-hmm. Since that picture was taken, a lot of new stuff was put in there. I'll try not to get glare on that. I'm standing in front of a glass door.
Wow.
So we have structure there. There's a gigantic cryostat, a cryogenically cooled instrument called Link Nirvana there now. And so the
this is a great name.
The telescope was pretty empty. We were able to walk freely anywhere we wanted. Now you have to crawl through it to gain access to the instruments. It's quite changed quite a bit. All right, I can't zoom in with this one. So okay, so I'm on the other side of the telescope now. So this is the other primary. So I've walked from the right to the left side of the telescope, and you can see off there, right in front of the window, the tertiary mirror. And basically, it's a symmetric telescope. So the left is virtually identical from the right. So I'm going to go up another level to level 7, which is kind of getting a little better view of looking down on the primaries.
You're making us all pant here.
Okay, yes. Okay, so I'll turn my camera again. So now I'm looking down on the primary.
Oh my, Jesus.
So it gives you a really funny optical illusion here.
Yeah, it does.
Because it's, as you move, you get that. But here I'm standing kind of in the upper structures of the telescope. And there's the adaptive secondary, which has a faceplate. So that optical surface, the shiny surface that you see, is a piece of glass that is only 1.5 millimeters thick. So that is, I don't know how that is in English units. That's like a less than a quarter of an inch, like an eighth of an inch.
Yeah.
And it's got 672 magnets mounted to the back of the glass. I'm going to turn my camera around for a second and talk to you face to face. So it's got 672 magnets and actuators that are backing it up that are glued to that piece of glass. And there's a box on the instrument gallery that measures the wavefront and measures how deformed it is. And then it sends signals up to that piece of glass and those actuators. And the glass is actually that 1.5 millimeter thick meniscus glass is deformed to counter the deformity of the incoming waveform. So this happens at 1,000 times a second. So really what we're achieving here, there's a theoretical diffraction limit for every telescope. I don't know what it is for an 8.4 meter telescope, but it's pretty small. Usually for your standard telescope, even with classic adaptive optics, you can only usually get somewhere between 10 and 40% of the theoretical limit.
If I did the calculation in my head quickly, I think you're 20 milliarc seconds in the middle of the visible.
Invisible, okay. Yes. Okay. So 20 milliarc seconds, I can't even think of how small of a patch of sky that is, but it's pretty small. Yeah. So typically your typical telescope that, you know, a 10-inch Celestron or Need can deliver a maybe 10 to 15% Strel, I think, on a really good night. Maybe less, I'm not sure. But this one can deliver 40 to 60% of the ideal Strel limit. Strel is named after a scientist named Strel, and he came up with the normalized metric to characterize how good your imaging is. And so ideal Strel is one. And so this telescope...
Whoops, we just lost your video.
There. Yes, because my son is trying to call me.
Hello.
Did I mention this was live?
And so where was I? Strel. Okay, yes. So this telescope will deliver in the visible 40% Strel. So 0.4 out of 1 ideal Strel. And at the near-infrared wavelengths, 60% Strel. And in the infrared wavelengths out to like 10 to 13 microns, 100%, or one Strel, perfect Strel. So we're doing perfect imaging with this telescope. So do you guys have questions?
Amazing.
You're very quiet.
Questions
we're
in the group?
In awe.
Nice.
I was going to ask about that.
Yeah, one question. How do you clean that mirror, those mirrors?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So that's a very good question. So there's a couple ways of cleaning the mirrors. And one is to, let me turn the camera around again to look at the primaries. One way is to use what's called CO2 snow. So what is deposited on the mirror, and since we don't have mirror covers, it's coming in from dust and pollen being blown through during the night when the enclosure is open, and we have a lot of moss up here as well. So the moss like to hang out on primary mirrors, and they shed their little silvery bodies all over the place. But it's mostly pollen. So you can use, what happens is that they have this machine that takes basically, how does it, it works by taking CO2 gas and condensing it onto your optics. And so in the process, it kind of makes it a fluffy mixture. And so what that does is it grabs the dust and dislodges it away from the glass itself.
How often do you CO2 snow clean?
Not often enough. So for this big of a telescope, it's a very laborious process. Mm-hmm. However, what we do on an annual basis is re-aluminize one of the primaries and wash the other one. So when I say re-aluminize, that means they strip the aluminum reflective coating off of this mirror. Okay. And so this summer we'll be doing this side that you're looking at. And you get guys with literally with mops and special booties with an acid mixture that eats away the aluminum. Ugh.
Green River.
Yes. And then they bring from the lower portions of the facility a vacuum bell jar that interfaces or sits on top of this the whole primary mirror.
Holy crap.
Because the primary mirror cell is a vacuum vessel. Okay, or it can be made into a vacuum vessel very easily.
Now keep in mind, again, this is 27 feet across. Yeah, this is not something that they can easily truck somewhere to have re-aluminized. Unlike, when here at BBSO, we removed our mirror and drove it out to Kitt Peak, last time we saw Tom, and had it coated there. They do it in place.
Incredible.
Hang on a second. Hey, David, I don't need the floods on anymore.
And so you can actually see the flange around the outside that can seal a vacuum-tight seal.
Yes, that's called the sfogato.
Sfogato.
Don't ask me to spell it. It's another Italian term, but it makes a seal around there. But there's a flat surface on the outside of the primary mirror cell, which is the vacuum seal. And it's you can think of a big dome that goes on top of this. And they pull a vacuum using lots of liquid nitrogen and big vacuum pumps. And then they shoot aluminum on the primary again. And just after they do that, they also wash the other side from all the dirt and crud that has collected for the year. So it's a long process. It takes 2 weeks to prepare, to do the aluminization, and to finish up. So we have a monsoon down period from this year it's July 10 through September 1st. And for the 2 weeks right around August 1st, we'll be aluminizing this mirror.
One possibly stupid question here, Tom. How do you, in the process of stripping the coating, how do you reach across half of that? That's 13 or 14 feet.
You actually see guys go out there with booties, and they are actually look like they have brooms, and they're scrubbing it.
They walk.
So the glass surface is this surface was polished to 50 nanometers, which is I don't know. Somebody used to say it's like much smaller than the width of a hair. So there's no peak or there's no bump larger than 50 nanometers from the rest of the mirror. And but it's a very solid, durable surface. So you can, you don't want to drop something on it, but you could, if you needed to, and if you had like nice soft socks, go out there and walk on it.
Oh man.
Now, we don't advise that. We don't let people do it because what happens is that you're scratching the aluminum surface. You're not damaging the glass, but you're scratching the aluminum surface. And so when you get little crazes and things like that on the aluminum surface, it starts to scatter light and it makes it harder to do the science.
How thick is that mirror?
The mirror itself, so this is a honeycomb mirror, which means that it has a thin faceplate of about 6 inches. So the optical surface is only about 6 inches thick.
Hmm.
And behind it is this waffle or beehive honeycomb structure that is about 2 feet thick. And that's what holds it rigid. And further in that, so there's all sorts of cavities behind it. And to cool, so you can imagine that even this is 35 tons of glass. So even with that much glass or even with that much light weighting, it takes a while to thermal equalize with the outside air temperature as it may change rapidly. So we have these jet injectors that are forcing cool air behind the mirror to force it into equilibrium with the outside air.
Mm-hmm.
And behind those are these actuators, which are pushing and pulling on the backside of the glass. Because you can imagine as the telescope rolls over, the glass is going to deform due to gravity.
Mm-hmm.
And so the actuators, these push-pull devices, are pulling or pushing different parts of the telescope to counter the deformity of the gravity. So it's an active optic. So this primary is an active optic, and the secondary that's above me is an adaptive optic. So all the optics are moving in quite dynamically. So the primary mirror is moving about once every second, so it's being updated once every second. And the adaptive secondary is doing once every a thousandth of a second.
What's that adjustment rate on your AO?
2K.
2K, right.
We're 2 kilohertz, but we only have 357 actuators where they have 600 whatever.
Right.
672.
So they have like twice as many actuators as we do here. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And I have a question. Is that why you don't have to use a whole series of mirrors to deal with your adaptive optics? Because you have more actuators?
Okay. So let me just interrupt you for a second because the telescope's moving to horizon. I'm going to look at the primary.
Their deformable mirror is the secondary mirror as opposed to further down on the optical train as we have here.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Look
at that.
Synchronization that you heard.
That'd be a fun ride on that.
The backside that we're looking at right now is going towards the roof. And so he'll be opening up the dome pretty soon. And I'll be moving shortly so that I'll be able to be down in front of the telescope as the slit opens. So I'm sorry, I got distracted with the telescope moving. So can you repeat the question, or maybe Claude actually
answered? I answered okay. Quickly. I have a question, however. A timely question. Here in Big Bear, our observatory is actually built on an earthquake fault, and we did have an earthquake here this morning. Do you, there on Mount Graham, do you have to worry about such things, and do you have earthquake clamps on the primary, or do you deal with that in some way?
No. I have experienced one earthquake in the 20 years that I have been in Tucson. It's been a pretty mild one compared to the ones that I've experienced in California. So I'm going to, so he's turned off the dome lights, and I'm going to kind of stand towards the back looking to the front. And I'm not sure if you could tell me when the slit's open, but I'll talk as we go. So we don't have seismic retrofitting, and we don't have clamps on the primary. Okay. However, it is solidly attached to the telescope now.
Is that a fixture for the secondary in front of you?
I say that again?
Is that a fixture for your secondary there in front of you?
Oh, what you see are these, they're called chrome rods. And so I'll look up again. I'm not sure if you can see that because it's kind of dark in there now. But the chrome rods are what the swing arms move back and forth on.
Oh, no, I was talking about
the secondary.
Okay, I was talking about that cart on the floor in front of you.
Oh. This is a cherry picker.
Oh, no.
No, it's straight.
Oh, the big round one?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that is actually the storage place for the spectrograph that are at the direct Gregorian. So this summer they'll be pulled off and stored in those locations for servicing. So we take the telescope apart quite a bit.
Oh,
So let's see. We'll look outside for a brief moment at the last light of the night. And you can see, I'm not sure you can see, but we've had a lot of bark beetle tree deaths around here. We've been suffering quite enormously. So right here I'm looking.
That's good. That's cool.
North.
Northwest.
And then on the other side,
so the bats to the...
we have had in 2000. Okay, actually, I'm going to back up right now because he's opening the shutter now.
Oh.
So you can see there's a pillar in the middle. which is the fixed plenum. So that's in between the two primaries. So we have a symmetric shutter that opens left and right. And there are big wings that slide out. So you can see, as I move up, that the roof is also opening up too, because the shutter is an L. So it goes from the floor all the way up to the very top. So as the shutters open, it takes about 2 minutes to open the shutter. I'm not sure if you can see in the background, but that's the, in 2004 we had a forest fire that came within about 200 yards of the facility. And we had the big helicopters flying over trying to save the building, and they did a very good job.
That's great.
It's like opening hangar bays over
so
the LTA base.
I'm looking south now.
The blimp hangars.
And you can see the belt of
Venus. And I'm going to turn back around and look at the telescope, because the telescope's pointing at 45 degrees right now. Mm-hmm. And the shutter door is just about completely open. It's got a little bit left to go. And so you can see the nice open from zenith all the way around. Now the telescope actually only operates down to about 25 degrees. We turned out that the we could use some parts of the telescope at lower elevation, but the adaptive secondary did not deliver very good performance below 25 degrees. That's unfortunate, and we're doing some improvements to, so there's a nice picture of the real Mount Graham off in the distance. We're on something called Emerald Peak, and we did not pick, nor could we pick, the very top of the mountain, because it is a sacred Apache mountain. And so there was actually quite a bit of controversy when the facility was being designed and constructed. And there was quite a bit of environmental activists to stop the construction of the observatory.
Secret, not secret.
So looking back to the telescope, and I should probably head out of the dome, because they probably might want to start to do flaps, and you know, the wind is high enough that my body heat isn't a factor. But
it is or is not.
It's not.
It gets colder and colder, and they don't want people in the dorm, in the dome, too much longer. So I'm going into the auxiliary control room, which is a little quieter and a little warmer. Whew. Okay, so what are the questions you have?
The LBT is a somewhat of a pathfinder for the GMT, obviously. Is there a projected life for this telescope, or is that open-ended?
Well, I think it's that's a very good question. And when you look at modern telescope facilities, there haven't been very many that have been decommissioned. So the one that I'm thinking of is the
McMahon,
perhaps. And that was due to mostly financial, right?
Yes.
I guess it's always
politics.
So I can see that this is an incredibly complex facility, and I spend sleepless nights thinking about what's going to break next, and how we can fight obsolescence. Because this telescope has been in existence, so they started construction in 1998, and so it's already 20 years old. Some of the infrastructure is 20 years old and already obsolete. So it's a constant struggle to keep telescopes operating and doing good science. And typically what happens is that there's a cost to science ratio that is really not specified, but you know, when the partners who operate this, since this is really a private organization that operates this telescope, when the partners want to quit, then I would imagine the facility could either be sold or it could be mothballed, and looking for somebody to come along and somebody with very deep pockets to resurrect it. But, you know, it's a big telescope. Even some of the smaller telescopes, as you know, on Kitt Peak, are still operating after 50, maybe 60 years. So I think it's got, you know, I think it's got probably at least 70 years in it. You know, hopefully the site and the scene conditions in Arizona will not degrade too much. No question. You know, so it's all okay. Many factors.
He could hear me. Yeah. Tom, I imagine observing runs there. Is your telescope always booked?
It's used every night that is clear, and it is except for the 6 weeks during the summer. So we operate year-round, and then during that 6 weeks in the summer, we're doing facility maintenance.
Got it. Is that
so? It is staffed 365 days a year, with a minimum of 3 people, and during the day we usually have a crew of about 20.
Wow.
That are doing maintenance and servicing. Now we are a facility that can operate remotely, but we always have a telescope operator local. We always have a designated site manager, and we also have one instrument specialist who are not resident on the summit, but they are doing shifts up here. So we are operating in a refugium, a red squirrel refugium, which means that we can't have people currently living up on the mountain due to the ecological impacts. So we have to truck in all the potable water and truck out all the gray water.
Wow.
But we do have power, commercial power up here. But everything else has to be trucked in and trucked out. So all of our garbage needs to go down all the way down the mountain. All of our food needs to come up. All of our water and gray water needs to come up and down the mountain. So we have, in the facility, we have about 20 bedrooms, which many times are full because we have big observing crews come in from Europe. So they are doing big campaigns where they're here for maybe 2 weeks. And they're doing science, and they have split shifts, and so they might have as many as 10 people in their crews. For example, tonight, the observers, there are 3 observers, and they're actually up on the mountain. It's pretty quiet. So tonight, there'll be a mountain manager, myself, 3 observers, and a telescope operator, and 1 instrument specialist. But I've been up here with only 3 people, and it's a big place to have only 3 people in it. It gets kind of lonely up here. But then again, I've been up here with about 50 people, and it's really crowded at that point. Did I answer your question? I'm not sure.
Yeah, you answered about 50 of them. Thank you.
Just a quick question, since you can use this as either 2 telescopes or 1 combined telescope.
I can't hear you.
Sorry. And since you can use this as either as 2 separate telescopes or a combined telescope, I'm just wondering what percentage of the time is actually used as a combined telescope?
So unfortunately, the volume there is garbled so much I can't understand the words. So perhaps somebody can relay.
Somebody can translate.
Can you understand me better?
Yes, I can.
Usually this microphone does pretty well. He was asking what time ratio do you have between combined binocular observations to using the two primaries as independent telescopes?
Well, most nights are using in what's called a binocular mode, which means we're using both primaries, but we're not combining the beams. So about 30% of the nights we are doing beam combining, where we're using the full resolution of the telescope at its maximum. That's with the interferometer. But not everybody wants to use the interferometer. The nice thing about having two telescopes on a single mount with two instruments is that you can do twice the observing at the same time. So really you can have a very highly efficient, even if you're not combining the beams together, you are actually taking images in perhaps two different wavelengths or two different filters, or you're taking spectroscopy and you're doing simultaneous imaging, which is a distinct advantage from every other telescope that I use.
Can you actually diverge the beam slightly and effectively
mosaic? Yes, you can. It's possible, but you can dither by, it's not very wide. I think you can do about up to 10 arc minutes.
Okay.
5 to 10 arc minutes.
You just...
it's not regular, but each side is independent from the other at a small scale.
And you described the instrument suite you have now. Are there new instruments that will be coming online in the near future, or are there ever visitor instruments that are hosted at the LBT?
There are no visitor instruments that are hosted. However, we do have a second generation of instruments that will come to the telescope starting in 2018. And there are three instruments that were selected. One is a visible coronagraph that will leverage. I should back up. We're in the process of upgrading our adaptive optics system so that it is about 10 to 20% more efficient, which means that we can correct the wavelengths better for bright stars, or we can lock on to fainter stars, which means we can cover more of the sky than we can right now. And we can achieve a better resolution in the visible. So the infrared were perfect, there's no need to change that there. However, in the visible wavelengths, there's much room for improvement. So that's what we're targeting right now. And so one of the instruments will leverage that improvement in the visible to do coronography of primarily extrasolar planets. So with the idea of imaging extrasolar planets, ultra high resolution imaging of extrasolar planets. Hmm. It's capable of doing other science such as galactic, extragalactic, nebula, etc. There's a companion instrument in the near infrared, which will basically be looking at a shorter wavelength than the perfect imaging, but it will also leverage the improvement of the adaptive optic system.
Well, you mentioned the going to fainter guide stars. Do you also use laser guide star, or do you only go with natural?
We do, and actually, I'm gonna drop my camera off and forward you an email, because there's a really cool, where is it? There's a really cool, here we go. I'm having trouble multitask right now, but if I just concentrate on quads, email. Are you able to pick up your email?
I'm working on it right now.
Okay, so I'm going to send this off right now. You should have it. It is a YouTube link to a movie, a time-lapse movie of the laser guide star activity
on the telescope.
Okay, I brought bringing up the video now.
Okay, it's pretty spectacular because it shows the telescope moving and the laser.
Something was said.
That's pretty cool.
Okay.
He's laughing. That is so
your,
cool.
Your head's off to the side of it a little bit.
All right. So I can see the green on your face, so you must be super quiet.
That's green.
Wow. That's incredible.
So, this system is called Argos, like the, who was it, the Argonauts ship.
Jason ship.
Jason and the Argonauts?
No, that's a green laser. That doesn't look like the typical sodium yellow. No.
It is a green laser. This is called a Rayleigh beacon, as in Rayleigh Jean's law, that Rayleigh. So, uses a visible green, and you're looking at... a guide star that is lower in the lower than the sodium level. So it's it's different than the sodium. I'm not sure it's better, but
uses backscatter. In other words,
it uses backscattering, and it's far more easier to implement than a sodium. Far more cheaper to actually service and keep going as well. So I believe that this is pretty much a winter night, so it's about 10 hours long. time lasts for 10 hours, and shows the beacons going on and off. And the reason why the beacons go on and off is because we have devices on our telescope that are monitoring the transmitters from aircraft.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, Mount Graham is under the flight corridor to LAX, so we get a lot of aircraft flying over us in the early evening.
Okay, now how do I bring you back up? Oh, okay, I have you back.
Okay, so it's impressive. The you can see the laser. You know, if you're standing outside, you can see just columns going up, converging to infinity like railroad tracks. Much further away, so if you're down in the valley, you're not going to see it. So it's not like it's blasting people out, but the entire dome is aglow in green. And they don't let anybody into the dome when the laser is projecting. So, and you can imagine why... you know, we need to turn it off when aircraft fly overhead.
So, totally.
Definitely blinding.
Other questions? Byron?
You can just reword it up there. How does he integrate the two images? Is it optically or electronically?
Optically. The question was, how do you integrate the two images, optically or electronically? In other words, how does the interferometer combine the images?
You can have your choice. So many times you can take simultaneous images left and right on the same chip. So this is like you have one detector and you have two different light beams coming in from each side of the telescope, landing on the same chip. So the trick to interferometry is not only to overlap the beams, but to align the waves of the light so that they are coherently interfering or constructively building on each other. So that's true interferometry, but however you can do imaging, left and right imaging, and then later go combine the images, and you can't get, you can't synthesize the resolution, but you can get all the other benefits of having two beams combined together. So more photons, full spectrum, you know, analysis of the object.
Stacking.
I saw some other hands. Other question?
He's an engineer, right?
Yes.
So he has to be there.
When after a year and the mirrors are dusty, what percentage does that throw off your, I mean, you talk about getting a 10% improvement here, and well, what percentage does dust degrade the...
Were you able to hear that?
The image.
No.
He was asking, after a year of dust and dead moss accumulating on the primaries, what kind of degradation do you see in your signal, kind of percentage loss? Or after cleaning and aluminizing, what reflectivity increases to you?
So think of the dust on this primary as, say, walking outside... you know, after kind of, well, you guys don't live in the desert, so it's like a haboob, you know, you see the dust storm. But, you know, there's some pollen on, you know, after you're underneath the tree.
We are in the pine forest here, and we have significant pollen.
You know, it's noticeable to the eye, and it does lend to some scattering of light, but actually a very small amount. It does lead to, in the infrared, to a brightening of the sky background. So the telescope is contributing to the brightness of your field and it's competing with the object that you're looking at. That is on the probably the 2-3% level over a year. Now, if we were really diligent about it and we have refined our instruments to take advantage of every photon, we would want to clean the mirrors regularly, more often, at least once before every infrared interferometry observation, or at least run of observations. And we're working towards that. But right now we are a lean organization, so some things do not. Aren't on the menu right now, but maybe in the near future. So the answer is, 3% maybe. About the, so if it were more than that, if it were 5 or 6%, we'd be cleaning the mirrors much more. The visible and the very near infrared instruments, they don't see any impact from the dirt on the primary. Now the coronagraphs that I was talking about, they're probably going to want us to clean our mirrors more often because they're really sensitive to scattering from particulate matter on the primaries.
Anything else?
Thank you.
Well, I think people here have run out of questions, Tom. So
okay.
Maybe let's thank Tom once again.
Well, it was my pleasure to host you for the evening here.